excitement. He prays, you know. Prays all day. Had a whole concert of Paul. the fantastic job, Paul. Thank you for blessing us with that tonight. I want to go into some various scriptures tonight. I want to preach on the topic vision and values. Values, vision, however you want to say it. Interchangeable thoughts. Especially in the different worlds that we live in. If you would, I want to start in Joshua chapter 1. In Joshua chapter 1. So you go there, and then we'll take you to another place in Joshua. And then I'm going to put this sermon tonight in kind of in two particular parts, talking about vision and values in general in our lives. And then looking back at what our church sees as vision and values. So you can go to Joshua, and we'll be reading in just a second. Almost, I guess, 2 years ago it was, just about 2 years ago, I guess, my job position at my work was changed. And I was put under, a brand new department that actually wasn't at the campus that I worked in. It was the first time that I worked for, I would say, a department that wasn't on my campus. I had a new supervisor, immediate supervisor, that I didn't really know that well. And then I had a new department head, a brand new boss. And in this change, as there is with any change, there are things that were taken away from my role because they weren't necessary anymore. They weren't needed anymore. And then there were things that were brand new that were tasked to me and tasked to our immediate team that had to be done. And I remember one of the first meetings we had. There were four of us who worked in the same position at the college, and so we had to go downtown and we had to meet under our human resources department. My particular department falls under human resources for some reason. And so we sat there in this really long meeting, and I felt like it didn't apply to us at all because we didn't do any of the things he was talking about. But we met with our big boss, the big boss of this particular department. And the first thing that he stressed to those who are coming under this department was our institution and our department's core values and its motto and its vision and how we fit into that. And over the next 2 years, he continues to stress these values over and over, not only in the college as a whole, but in our individual departments just as a college. And our vision and our motto in our particular department at work is this: enhance your career, enrich your life. Oh, isn't that great? Just ready to sign up. I work for training and organizational development now. So we have goals, we have missions, we have values that we stick to. Now, this isn't anything new. Companies and corporations and organizations, those that you that work, you have probably visions and values at the job in which you work. And think about this. There are different ways that these come across. Think about Subway. There's this eat fresh. That's what you're supposed to get when you get a Subway sandwich, right? And then there's Skittles. Remember, taste the rainbow. That's their motto. And did you know Google has an actual vision statement? I really didn't learn this until recently. It's our mission is to organize the world's information and make it universally accessible and useful. That's what Google is all about. Now, honestly, we all have values. We all have vision, and we all have mission that we have in our life. And some families even do this, and they don't even know. I want to show you a picture. You might see this in like a store, or in some people's homes. Have you ever seen something like that? And I have no idea who the Wilsons are. I just stole this picture from the internet. But, you know, it says this: in this family, we work hard. We keep our promises. We tell the truth. We count our blessings. ah, that's just cute. Let me hang it up on our wall. But I think there are some families who probably had that. I will say that they spelled Colossians wrong. That's not how you spell Colossians 3:23 under word hard. I mean, those are great, good, godly values for a family to have. And whether they're on a wall or on a plaque, every family has a vision and a motto, or they know it. And that goes up into the church world as well. Now, I don't know if you know First Baptist Church of Woodstock, Georgia, but with Johnny Hunt, I'm sure some of you have heard of Dr. Johnny Hunt. He's one of the greatest preachers that you'll hear. Whenever you listen to their preaching broadcast or their podcast, they always say their vision for their church. And it's this way: worship God, love others, serve God, invite others. Worship God, love others, serve God, invite others. That's Woodstock. And as we know here at the church, if you have one of our connection cards or t-shirts or business cards, you notice that there is always three words that we have, which is love, reach, and encourage. And those are not arbitrary words. They're not arbitrary in any way. These are our values. And this is a motto that we have pared down into three words. And I remember listening to something by Tom Rainer. He's written a lot of church growth books and church health books. And he says that you take your motto and you put it down into one or two word phrases so you can remember it yourself. And you know this is what you're trying to do at the church. I remember coming up thinking about what we want to say as a church a few years ago, and coming up with love, reach, and encourage. I was actually on this forum for pastors that Tom Rainer was actually a part of, and I said, well, we're Rolling Hills Baptist Church, and I put love something, reach something, encourage, and he said, I like where you're going, he said, but you need to make it three particular words that people can remember: love, reach, encourage. Occasionally, it's really good to return to the basics of what our values and our motto and our vision really is about. Now, unless I missed something, I kind of combed through the archives, and the last time we had a message or talked together about our values and our mission and our goal was May 2017. So that's been a little while ago to where we've had a particular message just about our vision. And the great thing is we've had new people come and be a part of us, and we've tried throughout the years to remember what love, reach, and courage is. And sometimes it's just nice to refresh ourselves. And this is, I don't prefer to do topical messages where I jump from place to place, but that's what I'm going to do tonight. And tonight I want to talk about our values, our vision, our mission, that summarized in those three words. And I want to start in Joshua chapter 1. So Joshua chapter 1. And I want to read verse 6-9. It says this: Be strong and of a good courage, for unto this people shalt thou divide for an inheritance the land which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou may observe to do all that is written therein. For then you shall make your way prosperous, and then you will have great or good success. Have I not commanded thee, be strong and of good courage, be not afraid, neither be dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee, whithersoever or wherever you go. Lord, help us tonight as we look at your word for a few minutes. Just remind us of the vision, the values that you have for every believer. In Jesus' name, amen. truly biblical, I believe, because it comes out of the Word of God. So let me give you two things tonight about vision, or about a motto, or a statement, however you want to say that our values, and we'll use the word value, is number one, and it doesn't matter where this is, in a church, in your personal life, on your job, on your in your house, our values should reflect God's will. Our values, the things that we value in our life, should reflect God's will. Now, that statement there is the most succinct way that I can say a whole lot of things. Our life values, our church values, our family values should reflect God's will. What do I mean by God's will? Everything that goes into God, let me put it that way, God's character, God's nature, God's glory, God's values, God's work, and God's plan. I use that word God's will because that's all I can think about. Everything we do, every ministry that we have, from the choir to the children's church to a benevolence ministry, to a ministry of reaching out to a hurting family or a guest or any of that, we should always reflect God's will. We should do that on our jobs. We should reflect God's character and His value and His word and His words. In our home, we should reflect God's will. Our character should be God's character as we encourage our spouse, or as we talk to our brothers and sisters, or as we raise children. Our values should reflect God's values. That picture that I showed, those were godly values that I believe that family should take and say, you know what, these are what we do believe in. You can never go wrong when you do your best to be an imitator of Jesus Christ. You can never go wrong when your values, when your mission in life imitates who Jesus Christ is. I'm jumping ahead of myself, but 1 Corinthians 11:1 says this. Paul says to the Corinthian church, be imitators of me as I am an imitator of Jesus Christ. Paul's not saying I'm Jesus Christ, but Paul said that I want my life and my goals and my values and what I do to imitate Jesus so much that I have no problem saying to somebody, you can imitate me because I'm doing my best to reflect God's will and God's purpose here on this earth. In Joshua chapter 1, Moses had died, and Joshua had been raised up to be the next leader of Israel. In verses 6 through 9, God gave a series of statements to Joshua, saying, you're now in charge, and this is what I want you to reflect to the people and tell the people. He said, be strong and of a good courage. In verse 5, don't miss this. He said, listen, I'm going to be with you all the days of your life, like I was with Moses. I'm going to be with you, and I'm not going to fail you. I'm not going to forsake you. And he said, be strong and be of good courage. I have something for you to do, so be strong and be of good courage. Observe my word. He says this in verse 7, and then he says this, follow me and be strong of a good courage. Then notice that theme throughout those verses over and over again. Notice God was the one who guided what Joshua needed to do. Joshua didn't say, all right, I'm in charge now, so let me come and give you my great idea, Israel, of what we're going to do to be successful. Man's plans fail. That's what the Bible says. But God's plans succeed. I'm summarizing a verse of Scripture. God gave Joshua the vision of what he wanted to do, and then he said, I'm going to be with you and do it. Listen to verse 2. Joshua chapter 1, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise, go over this Jordan, thou and all the people, unto the land which I give to children of Israel. Verse 3 says, everywhere you're going to go, I'm going to give you, I'm going to bless you. Now, think about this. That was a big task for a man just taken over and taken over after Moses, who had been there for such a long time and done such great things. But something is very why in verses 6, 7, and 9, God continually tells Joshua to be strong and be courageous over and over and over again. God's will, God's mission, God's values for you, your family, your job, whatever it is, often take us to be strong and courageous. Because sometimes God's dreams are bigger than our dreams, God's plans are bigger than our plans, and sometimes people can be very negative against those things. Maybe God has, for you, got to witness to a stubborn, hard-hearted person, a friend, neighbor, family member, and you know that's God's will for your life, and He tells you to be strong and be courageous. Maybe God says, I want you to be a part of this ministry or this ministry and do this, and you say, I know it's your will, and I want to do what you want me to do, but I'm scared to launch out. And God just says, this is what I called you to do. I know what's in your heart. Be strong and be courageous. This is all about what God says, and not what Joshua says. All of these things God wanted in Israel's life and in Joshua's life, Joshua had to hold on to the words of God for it to come to be. You know, I thought about this. If Joshua had a statement, if Joshua had on a t-shirt and he stood in front of the people of Israel and had his little motto, I think it would be this. Stay strong, stay courageous, follow God, follow His word. If Joshua had a mission statement, it would have been to remind himself and the people that, you know what, we need to stay strong. We need to stay courageous. Follow God. Follow His word. And you know what? That all came from God. That didn't come from Joshua. Our values in our life need to come from God. Our family values, our character values need to come from God's word. Does the way of your life, does the things that you hold dear, does your drive, your passion day to day, are they a reflection of God and the values of God? I mentioned this verse last week. I want to mention it again in Philippians 3:14. I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Jesus Christ. Paul said, my values, what I'm pressing towards in life, has to do with the high calling of God in Jesus Christ. And you might think to yourself, you know what, the things that I value probably don't amount to much in the world. Or the things that I want to do may not be but a drop in the bucket in my eyes. But to God, they are something that is big. They are something that He has called you to do. And He said, I'll be with you. Be strong and be of a good courage. Stick with me. Pressing towards the mark. Our values should reflect God's will. Secondly, our values should lead us to action. All of the values that we have lead us to action. If you're in the corporate world, if you're in an organization and in a ministry, it's nice to have a good slogan, but it's awful if that slogan does not call you to do any kind of action. Whenever God gave somebody some values or gave them a mission or whatever you want to call it, it led them to action. It was either an internal change, an external change, or it was something to do. Our values lead to action. If you go over to the 24th chapter of Joshua, the 24th chapter of Joshua, I'm going to read a verse or two there. 24th chapter of Joshua. This is where Joshua's story starts to come to an end. But notice what Joshua's message from God did before we read these verses. It caused him to be brave. It caused him to trust. It caused him to consistently stay in God's word. Remember, Jesus, God said, be strong, have a good courage, trust me, don't let this book of the law depart from me. It caused him to stay consistently in God's word, and it caused him to carefully follow God's path. Remember what God said in Joshua chapter 1, don't go to the left, don't go to the right, go where I tell you to go. So as Joshua's story ends in Joshua 24, listen to what verse 14 and 15 says. Now, therefore, this is Joshua talking to the people, fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the gods of your fathers that served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in the land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will, let me put that in parentheses, actively serve the Lord. Joshua, once he received God's mission and trusted in God that it would be, that he would be with him, he was able at the end of his life to confidently tell the people what they should do. He said this, choose you this day who you will serve. In order to follow God's values, in order for God's values and mission for your life to lead to action in your life, you have to choose to do it. You have to choose to go to church. You have to choose to evangelize. Teachers, you have to choose to study. You know what? Sometimes, I'll be honest, I want to just watch football. Sometimes I just want to, I'll be honest, play my video game or play with the child now. Yeah, that's the next thing that I have to do. But and it's easy just to sit there and to sleep and to get wrapped up and not study the Word of God. As they always say, and you Sunday school teachers will know it, you children's church teachers, choir leaders, all of you in here, Sunday's coming. Wednesday night's coming, and it's not going to stop. We have to know, we have to keep going. We have to choose to serve in a culture that is anti-Christian sometimes, very anti-Christian. We have to choose to stand for the Lord. We have to choose to stand to serve God. Joshua said, these things that we value, we say we value, they need to lead to action in our life. As for me and my house, Joshua said, I don't care if your neighbor serves other gods, he said. As for you and your house, you have the choice and the action to serve the Lord. He said, why? Because God has changed our lives. Regardless of your co-workers, regardless of your friends, and regardless of your family, there's some family that will start to not like you the more and more you get closer to the Lord and the more you decide to follow God's values and God's mission in the world and Christ's values. And you'll see that even family you were once close with, you're not close to anymore because they're going this way and you're going that way. Sometimes that hurts when you just can't sit down with a family member and feel that closeness anymore, simply because your values and your mission have led you to two different directions. But it's a choice. He said, no matter what your father served, no matter what your neighbors are doing, he said, you live in the city of the Amorites. They worship their gods, and that's what's popular. He said, but you have a choice today whether to follow God's values and vision. He said, but in order to do that, you must make the choice to do that action. God is sovereign over all, but he still gives man responsibility to do things. This is the same way for our church. What we value about God and his word, our concern for his will and his thoughts, is our kind of our last slide on here. You see this motto of love, of reach, and encourage. If you believe it, if you live it, it will come out. It will come out. Now, nobody's going to follow this perfectly. No one, because there's no one perfect. The only person who can do this perfectly is Jesus Christ. But this is very biblical, what we have. It's not because I came up with it, or a team came up with it, or somebody said that they like it. This is just straight from the Bible. This is straight from the Bible. And you know what? There's not many mottos and different values. You can say it different ways, but it all boils down to a couple of things that God has asked us to do. I just want to remind you what each one of these is about. The first one's love. Love should be the foundation of our ministry and the heartbeat of our ministry. Love should be the heartbeat of our ministry and the foundation of ministry. What do I mean? We should genuinely love Jesus Christ. To be on God's mission, we must genuinely love Jesus Christ. Listen to what Jesus said in John 14, 15. I'll let you write down the scriptures, but I won't turn to them tonight. But John 14, 15, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. If you love me, you will show it. We must genuinely love Jesus Christ. John, 1 John 4:19 says this, we love him because he first loved us. Always remember that. Your love for Christ, you didn't come up with it yourself. You felt the love of God through Jesus Christ. He loved you first before you loved him. And so, love should be the foundation of our ministry. We should genuinely love Jesus Christ. Secondly, we should genuinely love his word. Paul says this, long for the sincere milk of the word. Because we love his word, you know what we'll do? We'll teach his word. We will proclaim his word. To the kids, we will teach God's word. We will help them memorize God's word. In our Sunday school classes, we need to teach God's word, memorize God's word, proclaim God's word to the guests that come in here, and to each other. We should be, because we love Jesus, we should be a Jesus-calling church. My dad always would say, people are going to think you're an old Bible thumper. That's what they're going to say to you. But we should be a Jesus-talking, word-centered church. We not only need to love Jesus genuinely, we need to genuinely love his word, we need to genuinely love each other. Genuinely love each other. And sometimes that's really hard. That's hard for a variety of reasons I don't have time to go into tonight. Some of it's history. Some of it's personality. Some of it is whatever. But we need to learn, if we're going to be like Jesus, if we're going to live out number one, love, that we must genuinely love each other. John 15, 17. These things I command to you that you love one another. Jesus said this in John 13, 35, by this all people will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. Isn't that interesting? Not if you go to church, not if your name's on the membership, not if you have a position in the church, not if you do good deeds. People will know that you're my disciples because they'll see something that the world genuinely doesn't have. And also we need to genuinely love our community and city. That means the guests that come here. Genuinely love and care for them and their well-being. That means the outcast. That means the one who doesn't really offer anything. Now, that's a very harsh statement. You know, there may be somebody who comes and they don't have money to give. They may not have service they can give. Maybe they have a physical ailment. They say, you know, they don't have much to offer. Well, they don't understand that they really do have a lot to offer. We'll talk about that Wednesday night. But we need to genuinely love the people that come our way. Matthew 5, 43 says this, you have heard it said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and he sends rain on the just and on the love those who love you, what reward do you have? If we simply just love each other, he says this, then what reward do you really have? He says, because even tax collectors who are in the same company, they love each other because they're tax collectors. He's saying, those in the church, if you just love those in the church, you don't love the people around you, what good is it? If you only greet your brothers, what more are you doing than others? You know, even Gentiles did the same thing. You, therefore, must be perfect as your Heavenly Father is perfect. All people should be recipients of God's love. We should show it to them. We talked about reach at least tonight and then this morning. But here's this thing. I'm not going to re-preach the message, but we need to be reaching each other. There are people in here who need ministry. There are people who need a hug. There are people who need a kind word. And there are people who need to know that they have forgiveness. They have God's grace. They have God's mercy. There are some people who might need correction, a motivation, a place to serve. Some people might say, you know what, I didn't think I belonged in the church. Well, we need to belong. We need to reach each other. We need to reach the lost of our city. We need to be more evangelism-focused. We need to reach the unchurched and the de-churched. Church people, those who go to church, unchurched, they've not attended church for a long time. De-churched, they hardly ever have come to church. We need to reach the world. That's why we partner with missionaries. That's why we partner with missions organizations that are like-minded. That's why we partner with missions-minded organizations in the PMA and without the PMA. And last, to encourage each other in our walk with Christ. Listen to what Paul says in 1 Thessalonians 5:11. Therefore, encourage one another and build one another up. And then he says this, just as you are doing. Paul says you're doing a good job of encouraging one another. We need to encourage each other in our walk with Christ. We need to encourage the seeker to come to Christ. We should never have a person who comes our church or we encounter that we turn them off from wanting to follow Jesus Christ in our words and in our actions. We need to encourage the new believer in their walk with Christ. We need to encourage the believer to plug into ministry. And we need to encourage people no matter what age group they are. No matter what age group they are, you still have a say, you still have a voice, you still are important. Somebody who's young to somebody who is old. I believe we've made a lot of great strides this year, not only in terms of relationship, but in terms of spiritual things and physical things here in our church, from small things to some people say small, it was a lot of money to the AV system that was put in order to enhance some of our points of worship, to new ministries that were started. Our outreach is growing bigger and bigger, which we praise the Lord for. And it's all because we're just simply trying to follow Jesus' mission. And our mission is simple, love, reach, and encourage. However, it's just biblical. It's just what the Bible asks us to do. So my first question is, where do you fit in this motto?